Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Indiana Jones and Philosophy. Why Did It Have to Be Socrates? By William Irwin. Series edited by Dean A. Kowalski. Narrated by Jonathan Yen and Chloe Cannon. Introduction. Indiana Jones. I always knew someday you'd come walking back through my door. I never doubted that. Consider the Indiana Jones theme song. Go ahead. You know you want to keep humming. I'll wait. The Indiana Jones theme song is unmistakable. Harrison Ford cannot escape it, as he once remarked, tongue firmly in his cheek. That damn music follows me everywhere. They play it every time I walk on stage, every time I walk off a stage. It was playing in the operating room when I went in for my colonoscopy. Time, June 10th, 2016. Beyond the music, Indy's leather jacket, brown fedora, and bullwhip are simply iconic, forever ingrained in popular culture. We cannot escape Indiana Jones. Not that we would want to, of course. Harrison Ford deserves credit for the character's popularity. His ability to subtly play up Indy's foibles while playing down the character's heroism makes Indiana Jones relatable. Of course, Lucas and the screenwriters are also responsible, as they magnificently depict Indy battling antagonists seeking to possess mystical objects for world domination. But Indy is no mere action hero. He also struggles with unrequited love that lingers for decades, an estrangement from his overbearing father that lasts just as long, and a lifelong obsession with regaining an important object unfairly taken from him. As we know, Indy doesn't always choose wisely, and if the young Indiana Jones chronicles are to be trusted, he made many missteps in his youth on the way to becoming the hero we know and love. Indy loses a fight as often as he wins, and when he wins, he doesn't always fight fairly. In fact, he stumbles so often, one might wonder why he persists, decade after decade, toward his goals. He's not getting any younger. What's the point? And as he inexplicably trudges on, he, in the four films and various graphic novels, has many alleged encounters with the supernatural. He's not a religious person, at all. So what should he make of those? Should he take the leap of faith and become a believer? While we often see him conducting his highly unconventional fieldwork, spending an unusual amount of time in caves, he cannot completely ignore his day job, teaching undergraduates and aiding their pursuit of knowledge. But why should archaeologists strive to put artifacts in a museum or search for fact but not truth? And who is Dr. Tyree anyway? The Indiana Jones character is expressive of the human condition, vividly illuminating our struggles and issues on the big screen. True, we don't have John Williams's orchestra filling us with pride when we manage to do the right thing or play the part of the hero. Still, no one would blame you if you imagined Indy's theme blaring in the background while rising to meet a challenge. Have you started humming Indy's theme again? I hope you hear it many more times as you listen to this volume and relive some of your favorite Indiana Jones moments. Think of it now as you begin the first chapter. Part 1. It was wrong and you knew it. Ethics and Values. 1. Acting without thinking. The sagacity of Indiana Jones. Justin Kitchen. Indiana Jones gets the job done. He may stumble and fall along the way, but he picks himself up, Moore is forcibly picked up by a Nazi strongman and keeps going without hesitation. What motivates a person who rarely hesitates? How does Indy make such confident decisions in the heat of the moment? The answer lies not with a clear moral code or formula for how to behave, but with his character. Indiana Jones's confidence and spontaneity reflects his moral character. He's just a good person who is eager to be good. Philosophy can help us elaborate on this idea. According to many ancient virtue ethicists, people with the best characters are those who are most wise, so-called sages. Sure, Indy is a good person, but is he a sage? Once we get a handle on the quality of Indy's character and how he has become a good person, we'll be able to say whether he has attained sagehood or is at least heading in the right direction. Through it all, we can rest assured that Indiana Jones is at least a hero. But maybe we'll be able to understand what that word amounts to by comparing it to the ideal of the sage. Consequences or character? People adopt many different approaches when it comes to describing and justifying what's morally right. By far, the most popular approach is one that looks at the consequences of actions. This is broadly called consequentialism. Right actions are those that lead to good consequences. Another approach, instead, looks at the character of the moral agent. This is called virtue ethics. Right actions are those performed by agents with good character, those who exhibit virtue. We'll be taking the virtue ethics approach because of its focus on the moral agent, the person doing the moral action, rather than the action itself. If we took the consequentialist approach and focused primarily on Indiana's actions, more precisely, the consequences of his actions, we might encounter some problems. The character Amy Farrah Fowler from the CBS sitcom The Big Bang Theory expresses one such problem regarding Indy's role in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Indiana Jones plays no role in the outcome of the story. If he weren't in the film, it would turn out exactly the same. If he weren't in the movie, the Nazis would have still found the Ark, taken it to the island, opened it up, and all died, just like they did. Amy's argument is strong. In fact, we could make her argument even stronger by correcting the claim that the Nazis would have taken the Ark to the island regardless of Indy's interference. A major scene in Raiders centers around Indy and Marion trying to board the plane set to fly the Ark to Berlin. If Indy did not interfere in the Nazis' archaeological expeditions, the Nazis would have still found the Ark, taken it to Berlin on an unexploded airplane, and opened it up in the presence of the Führer or some other high-ranking officials. This is a hypothetical scenario of a fictional story, but the theory holds water, and it befuddles anyone who is taking a consequentialist approach. Indy actually might have produced worse consequences by redirecting the Ark and keeping more important Nazis out of danger. If Indiana's actions do not bring about good consequences, or worse yet, if they cause harm, then his actions are not morally right according to consequentialism. This is a problem for fans of the movie because the conclusion conflicts with our strong intuitions that Indy is really a good guy, if not a hero. Indeed, our intuitive admiration of heroes, including Indiana Jones, does not seem to depend on any of this consequentialist arithmetic. Adding up the harmful outcomes, subtracting that from the beneficial outcomes, and comparing the net total to some hypothetical scenario in which the action in question did not take place. The moral quality of Indy's actions doesn't actually hinge on hypotheticals at all. We admire Indiana Jones and his actions because of who he is, because of the good character he displays when he throws himself into the mix of things and tries to act rightly. So, if some smarty pants like Amy says to you that Indy is not really the good guy we think he is because he doesn't influence the outcome of events, you can point out the assumption she's making. Whether or not someone is a good person doesn't exclusively rely on the outcomes of his or her actions. Rather, moral goodness crucially depends on the quality of one's character revealed by that person's actions. I'm making this up as I go. Since we've settled on assessing Indiana Jones and his conduct using virtue ethics, we have to examine his words and actions in order to find evidence of good character. When we do this, we find a hitch in our plan. What matters to virtue ethics is not that you succeed in doing the right thing, but that you try to do the right thing. Although Indiana Jones seems to exert a lot of physical effort, someone might argue that in many cases, he doesn't appear to be trying very hard. That is, the decisions Indiana Jones makes throughout his adventures don't often appear well thought out. We could cite 3 cases when Indy's lack of deliberation or planning is made very apparent. In Raiders, Indy, meet me at Omar's, be ready for me, I'm going after that truck. Sala, how? Indy, I don't know, I'm making this up as I go. In The Last Crusade, Elsa, what are you going to do? Indy, don't know. I'll think of something. In The Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, Mutt, what's he gonna do now? Marion, ha! I don't think he plans that far ahead. You would think that someone with good character would be more thoughtful about these serious, life-threatening situations. This is especially problematic because what makes Indy so endearing is that he's spontaneous, and that there's a confidence in his spontaneity. So, for us to be confident in our application of virtue ethics, we need to square these 2 thoughts. We'll have to get a better sense of what it means to have good character and be virtuous. Then we'll have to see whether Indy's "I'm making this up as I go along" attitude makes sense according to virtue ethics. Winter training. The word virtue is a common translation of the ancient Greek word arete, which can also be translated as excellence. So we should say that if something is virtuous, then it's excellent. But excellent at what? In ancient Greece, famed philosophers Plato, 428 to 348 BCE, and Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, use the word to describe what makes anything excellent. A pruning knife is virtuous when it's excellent at pruning vines. A harpist is virtuous when they're excellent at playing the harp. Eyes are virtuous when they're excellent at seeing. These things are excellent at what they're meant for, what they're uniquely capable of. So when ancient virtue ethicists called a human being virtuous, they were saying that the person is excellent at being and doing what humans are uniquely capable of being and doing. After Aristotle, the concept of virtue was elaborated upon in different ways. The ancient school of Stoicism continued to develop the virtue ethics approach up through the 2nd century CE. The Stoics insisted that humans are uniquely capable of being rational and social. Thus, human beings are virtuous when they're able to exercise reason well and be congenial with each other. Even if humans are prone to being rational and social, it still takes a lot of hard work to be excellent at being human. For starters, it takes many years for children to fully develop their rational faculties and social intelligence. And by the time they actually develop these capabilities, they have been inculcated with values and beliefs that may be irrational or antisocial. If so, it would take a lot of hard work to recognize this and set themselves straight. But as the Stoic Epictetus told his students, no bull reaches maturity in an instant, nor do men become heroes overnight. We must endure a winter training and can't be dashing into situations for which we aren't yet prepared. It makes sense that it takes a lot of hard work and preparation for someone to reach this state of excellence. We don't admire people who accomplish things that are easy. Indy's winter training, when he undertook all the hard work that made him the hero we know and love, is the subject of The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones, also known as The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles. This television series showcases Indy's many adventures during his formative years as a child and young adult. Episodes mostly center around Indy becoming aware of his shortcomings and learning important moral lessons from various role models. Young Indiana's adventures fit well into what the Stoics described as the proper path of moral education. Epictetus's teacher, Musonius Rufus, 25 to 95 CE, introduced some popular analogies between moral education and other kinds of education. The doctor and the musician must each not only learn the principles of his own skill, but be trained to act according to those principles. Likewise, the man who wants to be good must not only learn the lessons which pertain to virtue, but train himself to follow them eagerly and rigorously. The Stoics insisted that moral education, as with proper medical and musical training, actually has two stages, a theory stage and a practice stage. As with medicine, we must first study a bit of theory. This just means examining our assumptions about how we should behave and making sure we have the right idea about what's good and bad, virtuous and vicious. This is what the prepubescent Indy does when he confronts his wrong assumptions or plain ignorance about life and learns from his mistakes with help from T.E. Lawrence, Teddy Roosevelt, Krishnamurti, and others. Here's a particularly poignant lesson that Indy learns, at least at the theoretical level. Krishnamurti, I want you to think of something you want more than anything else in the world. Young Indy, I want to live forever. Krishnamurti, but everybody has to die. You cannot live forever. How does that make you feel, Indy? Young Indy, I feel sad, I guess. Krishnamurti, that is the answer to your question about why people suffer. You see, people want things they cannot have, and that makes them sad, and they suffer. After we get oriented with theory, then comes the more difficult process of really internalizing this information through practice. In medicine, this stage entails a long internship and residency under attending physicians. But in ethics, this entails life experience and honest conversations with other good people. This is what the teenage and young adult Indy does in fighting alongside revolutionaries, activists, and the Allied forces of World War I. But, as Indy himself put it, you don't start at the top. You work your way up, perfect your style until you are at the top. Indy was referring to waiting tables as a college student, which requires less theoretical training, but the sentiment could apply to all kinds of human excellence, including virtue. By the time we reach the events in Temple, Indiana Jones has perfected his style and has achieved a noticeable form of excellence. I'm not talking about being an excellent archaeologist or teacher, but an excellent overall human being. Excellent at being rational and social. He has cultivated his rationality by vetting his beliefs about right and wrong and addressing his prejudices. He has cultivated his sociability by relating to other people and sympathizing with their causes. And for the Stoics, this is what it means to be virtuous. But how can we really tell that Indiana Jones has become virtuous? What has all his moral education and training amounted to? Again, according to the Stoics, we can distinguish a virtuous sage from a less than virtuous person by how they act and make decisions. So, let's now examine how Indy makes decisions. Knowledge was their treasure. The Stoics said that someone who has become excellent, who has become virtuous, lives consistently or harmoniously. The Greek word is homologomenos. Such people live harmoniously with themselves because they're acting rational, free from contradictory beliefs and bias. They live harmoniously with others because they're being congenial, showing compassion toward other people and helping them when they can. This harmony is what led the founder of Stoicism, Zeno, to describe virtue as providing a smooth flow of life. Once someone has become virtuous, continuing to be virtuous and navigating through life should be as easy as swimming leisurely downstream, going with the flow. Here's the Stoic Seneca, 4 BCE to 65 CE, describing this special person, what has come to be called the wise person or sage. He was always the same, consistent in every action, good no longer from policy, but under the guidance of a habit that made him not only able to act rightly, but unable to act other than rightly. In him we understood that virtue had been perfected. That man's orderliness revealed virtue to us, his seemliness and consistency, the harmony among all his actions, and his greatness in surmounting everything. It was thus that we came to understand happiness, the life that flows smoothly and is completely under its own control. Considering that Indiana Jones has gone through a very thorough, Stoic-like moral education, we can see some sage-like qualities. This isn't in reference to his outward appearance, of course. He's obviously not the contemplative, long-bearded sage we know from religious texts or kung fu movies. Stoic sages live harmoniously and enjoy a smooth flow of life. Not because they're still and fluid in their motions and easily avoid every punch thrown at them. Rather, the harmony that sages experience is in their decision-making. Their good decisions flow out of them. They just intuitively know what the right thing to do is without having to deliberate. Indy's quick, spontaneous, and confident decision-making, which always seems to be the right decision, is the key evidence for his potential sagehood. He appears to not hesitate, or even think, when cornered into a tight spot. Oh, the plane ran out of fuel and is careening toward a mountain? Everyone get in the lifeboat. Oh, an atomic bomb is about to go off? Ah, here's a lead-lined refrigerator. These examples may seem ridiculous, but instead of guffaws, maybe we should be awestruck at how much moral education and training Indy has undergone, to the point where he can stay clear-minded and make the best choices possible, considering the circumstances, with little to no deliberation. In fact, we can add examples more commonplace but equally deserving of admiration. Swinging on his whip or a vine, running off platforms or under doors, and even engaging in quick repartee with his sidekicks and love interests. Far from pointing to Indy's thoughtlessness and counting it against him, we should admire him more, knowing that he has trained himself to be unencumbered by the thought process. A more conventional way that virtuous people are described is by talking about the so-called cardinal virtues, courage, temperance, justice, and prudence. The Stoics insist that the cardinal virtues are just different ways to talk about the knowledge that people acquire through their two-stage moral education. Courage is knowledge of what should truly be feared and what is not to be feared. Temperance is knowledge of what truly should be desired. Justice is knowledge of what others indeed deserve, be it tangible or intangible. Prudence is knowledge of what someone actually should do when it comes to actualizing the other three virtues. The insight that Indy expresses at the end of Crystal Skull, "Knowledge was their treasure," can be appropriated and expanded by virtue ethics. Knowledge is our treasure. It is the most valuable thing a human can possess, according to the Stoics. It not only underpins our beliefs, it also allows us to be truly courageous, temperate, and just. Indy has learned that not much is to be feared. He has a good sense of what's not dangerous, and he seems to know how to navigate things that are dangerous. This manifests in the spontaneous acts of courage, like the lifeboat and refrigerator examples. Indy has learned that not many things are desirable in themselves. He pursues valuable artifacts, but only because they belong in museums where the public can appreciate and learn from them. This manifests as spontaneous acts of temperance when he runs through treasure chambers without a second glance, focused on the tasks at hand. Indy has also learned that people deserve more appreciation than a fortune and glory approach allows. This manifests as spontaneous acts of justice and compassion. An important example of this occurs in Temple. There's a remarkable moment when Indy first gets possession of the Sankara Stones and starts to make his exit from the underground temple, when distant sounds of agony stop him in his tracks and compel him to investigate. The fact that many of Indy's actions can be described as courageous, temperate, and just is important evidence for his virtue and potential sagehood. And just as important is that these actions flow out of him during his adventures confidently and spontaneously, without hesitation or deliberation. What initially seemed like a flaw becomes a crucial feature of a good person. Fortune and glory, and snakes. What counts against Indy are the instances where his actions are not in line with the cardinal virtues, where he expresses irrational fear, irrational desire, or when he does not treat others in a manner they deserve. Let's rip the bandage off quickly. Indy is not a sage. He has learned and internalized a lot of moral knowledge, but he has also displayed some behavior that is not consistent with that of a sage. Though courage is the most prominent cardinal virtue that Indy exhibits, we all know of one instance where he falters. Yes, snakes. It had to be snakes. Indy's emotional reaction and hesitation toward snakes indicates that he has some work to do. Of course, snakes should be approached with caution, especially cobras and asps, which are very dangerous, as Sala reminds us. But they should not be feared to the point where one's rational decision-making is compromised. This seems to happen to Indy every single time he spots a snake, except when they are served for dinner, for some reason. But in most cases, they are relatively harmless boa constrictors, garter snakes, or rat snakes. In fact, recalling Crystal's skull, when Indy insists that Marion and Mutt call the giant rat snake a rope, only then, and only after closing his eyes, will he grasp it and be rescued from the dry sand pit, not quicksand pool, he is currently sinking into. In this encounter, like all the others, Indy gets through without a scratch. But all the snake encounters provoke a rare, cowardly, panic-stricken reaction in him, indicating that he has not internalized some basic theoretical knowledge about snakes. There are at least two moments that serve as examples of Indy's intemperance. During Temple, he plays a playful waiting game with Willie Scott in Pangkat Palace. After 5 minutes is up, and before he gets strangled by an assassin, he says to himself, "She's not coming. I can't believe I'm not going." Though this comment seems innocuous, it reveals an internal conflict regarding what he should desire. In other words, it's a subtle sign of intemperance. Another better-known example occurs at the end of Crusade. Indy's brief flash of greed when he comes within reach of the Holy Grail seems to expose a rare shortcoming concerning his temperance toward artifacts. Perhaps he has not fully internalized the lesson that Krishnamurti taught him as a child. Everybody has to die. You cannot live forever. Or perhaps he has some false beliefs about how the Grail can help the relationship with his father. Regardless, that lapse in judgment is another sign of an irrational intemperance that wouldn't be found in a true sage. Lastly, like many action heroes, Indy has some dysfunctions in his personal relationships that are inconsistent with the virtue of justice. It wasn't until the events of Crusade that he made amends with his father, and it wasn't until Crystal Skull that he made amends with Marion. A sage strives for harmony with all people, and though the term stoic brings images of a cold, unsympathetic, insensitive type, the ancient Stoics insisted that the sage is receptive to the concerns of others and exercises compassion whenever possible. In fact, the sage is especially effective at attending to the suffering of others because of his clarity of thought and lack of irrational biases. Indiana Jones is certainly responsive to the suffering of others, but he has needed work addressing the hang-ups in his relationships. Overall, Indiana Jones is doing very well by the Stoics' standards. He might not be a sage, but he seems to be getting closer to sagehood after every adventure. Perhaps he has become a sage at the very end of Crystal Skull. We can't know for sure until we observe him in the fifth installment. Our analysis here allows us to better appreciate Indy's off-the-cuff remarks about making things up. Indy has earned the right to make things up as he goes along. He has developed his intuitive know-how when it comes to being courageous, temperate, just, and prudent. He can appeal to that most of the time because he is very close to attaining the level of sagehood. And though he is not a sage, he is a hero in every sense of the word. Our hero. Because we can't, yet, label Indiana Jones as a sage in the ways that the ancient virtue ethicists used the term, I think hero is an acceptable term for someone who displays sage-like qualities. This is not a radical idea. The term hero is often used to describe someone in real life who displays the qualities we have already highlighted in Indy. Confidence, spontaneity, and a lack of deliberation when it comes to doing the right thing. As we've learned, this is a sign of good character and moral excellence similar to that of a sage. The Carnegie Hero Fund awards a medal and monetary benefits to those who perform extraordinary acts of heroism. According to Carnegie, a hero is a person who knowingly and voluntarily risks his or her own life to an extraordinary degree. This definition emphasizes the external aspect of the hero, his or her heroic act. This makes sense because the Carnegie Hero Fund can only reward people when there are witnesses to their heroism, and no one can witness a person's character directly. This is why we examined Indy's actions through this chapter, as a way to get at his character. But the Carnegie definition can be supplemented with our own common sense beliefs and with empirical research on people who are considered heroes. Research shows that those recognized as heroes by the Carnegie Hero Fund perform acts of extreme altruism, intuitively, without thinking, and as a matter of habit. As the researchers put it, the cognitive processes they describe are overwhelmingly intuitive, automatic, and fast. If this intuitive, thought-free behavior is the product of a thoughtful education, we can discuss the Carnegie heroes in the same manner as we discuss Indy and other heroes with similar qualities. They may have cultivated good character to the point that courageous actions can flow effortlessly from them in high-pressure situations. Lastly, it's important to emphasize that this all aligns with our common-sense view of heroes. The most vivid and common examples of heroes include firefighters who run into burning buildings and police officers or soldiers who run toward danger rather than away from it. At the time this chapter is being written, the COVID-19 pandemic has placed other occupations firmly in this group. In particular, doctors and nurses, who often undertake the right actions quickly and intuitively, despite knowing they are at risk of contracting the disease. Though Indy is fictional, he is a model we can examine to better understand what it means to be a good person. Indy is good not because of the consequences he produces, but because of his character. He has oriented himself well through years of self-examination. He has strengthened his convictions and character through years of practice. Indy isn't perfect. He's not a sage. But he's close. He acts in accordance with what he knows is right, with courage and moderation and justice, and he acts without much, if any, deliberation. This is a mark of sagacity and sage-like heroism cultivated through a theoretical and practical education. Yes, Indiana Jones often acts without thinking and without planning far ahead, and that's admirable. 2. Does it always belong in a museum? Eduardo Perez. Blinding rain batters the Coronado on the Portuguese coast. As the nighttime storm rages, three sailors detain Indiana Jones. A man in a white suit carefully makes his way to the main deck. Donning a matching white Panama hat, the man announces, "Small world, Dr. Jones." "Too small for two of us," Indy drolly replies. Panama Hat reaches into Indy's belt for the Cross of Coronado and says, "This is the second time I've had to reclaim my property from you." To which Indy quickly retorts, "That belongs in a museum." Growing weary of Dr. Jones, Panama Hat counters, "So do you. Throw him over the side." Just then, a giant wave slams into the ship, knocking everyone off their feet. The cross skitters across the deck. Indy grabs it and jumps off the ship just before it explodes. Clutching the cross and a life preserver, Indy spies a white Panama hat floating away. Indiana Jones's quest for the Cross of Coronado began 26 years earlier in 1912 Utah. That time, as a Boy Scout, Indy encountered Panama Hat's tomb-robbing henchmen led by Fedora. Indy never learned his name either. That was the first time Indy declared the Cross of Coronado belongs in a museum. Despite his clear conviction that artifacts like the Cross of Coronado belong in a museum, he never really explains why. What's more, he doesn't always act on his belief. In this chapter, we'll explore Indy's famous mantra and attempt to do what Indy never did, namely, explain why it might be true and why he doesn't always take his own advice. As we'll learn, it might not have anything to do with the artifacts themselves, but the good, or not, that comes of their being on public display for all, including scholars, to see. Obtainer of Rare Antiquities. The Last Crusade begins with a flashback to Indy's youth, where the late River Phoenix gives us a brief origin story, showing us how Indy eventually became the eminent archaeologist and obtainer of rare antiquities portrayed by Harrison Ford, as well as showing us why Indy fears snakes, uses a whip, and has a scar on his chin. What's significant, other than Phoenix's memorable performance, is that Phoenix's Indy offers the closest thing to an explanation for the belief that artifacts belong in a museum. When encountering Fedora's men on top of the circus train, Phoenix's Indy reminds the bandits that the Cross of Coronado belongs to Coronado. Fedora corrects him. Coronado is dead. So are all of his grandchildren. With that, Indy reaffirms that it belongs in a museum, which reminds us of the earlier, and much quieter, exchange between Indiana and his young friend Herman. Upon discovering Fedora and his crew in the Utah cave, Phoenix's Indy quickly assesses the situation. It's the Cross of Coronado. Cortez gave it to him in 1520. That cross is an important artifact. It belongs in a museum. While referring specifically to the Cross of Coronado, Indy expresses an argument that pertains to all artifacts. He states the first premise. That artifact, the cross, is an important artifact. He leaves the second premise unstated. Important artifacts belong in a museum. These two premises logically lead to the conclusion that important artifact, the cross, belongs in a museum. This is a start, but unfortunately, Phoenix's Indy does not explain why he thinks either premise is true, so we are left guessing about his reasoning. Still, two things remain clear. Indy has made a career of pursuing artifacts that certainly seem important, and he almost always believes that they belong in a museum. The viewer meets Indiana Jones in Raiders of the Lost Ark. Set in 1936, Indiana laments to Marcus Brody about losing the golden idol to the dastardly René Belloc. "I had it, Marcus. I had it in my hand." Brody is a curator at the National Museum and not a teaching colleague at Marshall College, which explains Indy's follow-up point. "Look, I got these pieces. They're good pieces, Marcus." To which Marcus replies, "Indiana, yes, the museum will buy them, no questions asked." There are two points here. On the one hand, Indy intends to spend that money on a plane ticket to Marrakesh so he can retake the golden idol from Belloc and then present it to Marcus and the National Museum. On the other hand, this serves as a reminder that Indy often deals with Brody and his museum. Of course, Indy doesn't go to Marrakesh, but becomes focused on the Ark of the Covenant. After Indy's meeting with the government men, he awaits their decision at his home. Indy apprehensively opens the door when Marcus arrives. His fears turn to elation when Marcus shares, "They want you to go for it. They want you to get a hold of the Ark before the Nazis do, and they're prepared to pay handsomely for it." But Indy doesn't care about the money. "And the museum? The museum gets the Ark when we're finished?" When Marcus assures him of this, Indy reminisces. "The Ark represents everything we got into archaeology for in the first place." When Marcus reminds him that, "For nearly 3,000 years, man has been searching for the lost Ark," and suggests caution due to the Ark's unknown secrets, Indy reminds him of his goal. "I'm going after a find of incredible historical significance. You're talking about the boogeyman." So, here too, Indy pursues an artifact of obvious historical significance, solidifying its importance, with the goal of placing it in a museum, presumably to facilitate future study and enhanced appreciation. Fortune and glory. In between Indy's youthful pursuit of the Cross of Coronado and his search for the lost Ark of the Covenant is the curious case of the Mayapur Sankara Stone. This is one time that Indy explicitly violated his "that belongs in a museum" credo. Temple of Doom is distinctive, infamous for its darker tone. It includes enslaving and torturing children, sacrificially pulling a still-beating heart from a man's chest, and drinking the mystical blood of the Kalima. It also casts Indiana Jones in a more dubious light. He intends to trade the remains of Nurhaci, the first emperor of the Manchu dynasty, for an impressive-looking diamond. Indy is very explicit about this. Lao offers him a small bag of expensive-looking gold coins, but Indy complains, "The deal was for the diamond, Lao." Indy goes so far as to threaten Willie Scott's life if Lao doesn't uphold the agreed-upon terms. This makes Indy seem like a black market dealer and not an archaeology professor intent on adding to Brody's Chinese collection. With some help from his assistant Short Round, and almost none from Willie, Indy narrowly escapes Lao Che's double-cross. Indy, Willie, and Short Round flee Shanghai on a cargo plane. But the plane is owned by Lao Che, whose pilots sabotage it, leading to the crash landing in India. The trio, drifting in their yellow life raft, come upon the Mayapur shaman, who escorts them to his village. The village elders believe that Shiva brought Indy to their village so that he could rescue their stolen Shivalinga, a sacred rock that protected the village. The shaman affirms, "We prayed to Shiva to help us find the stone. It was Shiva who made you fall from the sky. So you will go to Pankot Palace to find Shivalinga and bring it back to us." Although it seems like an incredible coincidence that an archaeologist who is an expert in the occult just happened to crash land near Mayapur, Indy is skeptical of any supernatural involvement. He calms Short Round by saying that the shaman was telling a ghost story. Indy becomes more sympathetic when he learns that, in addition to the Shivalinga, the Mayapur children have also been stolen. When a young boy escapes Pankot that evening and informs everyone of their plight at the palace, and provides Indy with an ancient scroll depicting Shiva bestowing magical rocks to the priest Sankara, Indy agrees to travel to Pankot. But his intentions remain muddled as he tells Short Round, "I think that somebody believes the good luck rock from this village is one of the lost Sankara stones." When Short Round queries, "Who is Sankara?" Indy answers, "Fortune and glory, kid. Fortune and glory." Of course, the Mayapur Shivalinga is indeed one of the fabled Sankara Stones, and Indy, Willie, and Short Round go to great lengths to rescue it from Mola Ram and his thuggy cult. In the process, Indy frees the Mayapur children. On their return trip, they find Mayapur changed. What was once a destitute and desolate village is now a vibrant community teeming with hope and life. Indy returns the stone to the shaman, who, rhetorically, asks, "Now you can see the magic of the rock you bring back?" To which Indy affirms, "Yes, I understand its power now." Willie reminds him of his original purpose. "You could have kept it." Without contradicting her, Indy replies, "Ah, what for? They'd just put it in a museum. It'd be another rock collecting dust." Willie further reminds him, "But then it would have given you your fortune and glory." Indy suggests that his fortune and glory would have come from selling the stone to Brody's museum, and not selling it on the black market, as he seemingly did with Nurhaci. But Indy declined that opportunity and made his way to Delhi without the Sankara stone. He doesn't fully explain his decision, but he seems to believe that more good would come from leaving it with the Mayapur villagers. That choice is better than the alternatives. Right down the hall. When attempting to determine what one ought to do, we often ask, what is best for everyone involved? Clearly, if an action will bring only pain and suffering and no positive results, that is excellent reason not to choose it. This sort of ethical thinking is called consequentialism because it stresses the consequences produced by our actions. Consequentialists believe that only positive or negative consequences, happiness and pain or suffering, matter, morally speaking. Jeremy Bentham, 1748-1832, is a classic consequentialist who often spoke of the utility of one's actions. He defined utility as that principle which approves or disapproves of every action whatsoever, according to the tendency which it appears to have to augment or diminish the happiness of the party whose interest is in question. Contemporary scholar Philip Schofield further explains, "The principle of utility was concerned with calculating the consequences of an action in terms of the pleasures and pains it produced on every individual affected by that action. The question as to whether an action was right or wrong was a question of fact. It would depend on the value, understood in terms of quantity, of the pleasures and pains which would be brought into existence by the act in question." For consequentialists like Bentham, who apply the utility principle to each possible course of action, we ought to choose the one that produces the most good, that is, happiness or pleasure. For example, when Indy catches a very young and orphaned Short Round picking his pocket, he could turn him into the authorities, send him to a local orphanage, or serve as a quasi-foster father. Presumably, he chose the third option because it would produce the best consequences for both Short Round and, arguably, himself. Consequentialists are quick to remind us that we must take into account the happiness and pain and suffering of everyone affected by one's choice. Further, very rarely will an action bring about only happiness or only pain and suffering. Typically, every scenario involves a mixture of both. By becoming Short Round's foster father, Indy takes on a great deal of responsibility, which will require effort and include some hardship. Not everything will go smoothly, ranging from playing poker together to being held hostage by Mola Ram. Indy would suffer far less hardship if he simply turned Short Round into the local authorities. However, he also benefits from Short Round's company, And Short Round's life is vastly improved compared to living on the streets as a young orphan in Shanghai. Overall, Indy becoming his foster father is the best choice. By stressing the consequences of one's action, consequentialists may deny that any acts, including murder, are inherently morally good or bad. This is controversial, but consequentialists are quick to remind us that some actions typically cause a great deal of pain and suffering, which allows for the existence of moral rules. As a rule, then, one ought to tell the truth or keep promises, because doing otherwise almost always causes more pain and suffering than happiness or pleasure. Still, consequentialists admit that, technically, any recognized moral rule can be overturned by carefully applying the utility principle to the circumstances at hand. If I just sit down and think, the solution presents itself. Consequentialism offers a way to understand Indy's insistence that important artifacts belong in museums, which might also shed light on the reasoning that drives young Indy's implicit argument in Crusade. Indy perhaps believes that, as a rule, important artifacts belong in a museum because the general population can benefit by viewing and learning about them. When important artifacts are placed in a museum, scholars have ample opportunity to study them carefully, which enhances our understanding and appreciation of them. We better see their historical and cultural importance. Further, the museum will keep them safe and ensure their upkeep, so the general public can continue to benefit by learning about them for generations to come. What's more, placing important artifacts in museums produces far greater positive consequences compared to keeping them in private collections. Private collections are viewed only by the owner, and perhaps a very select few who the owner allows access. True, the owner benefits greatly, but the positive consequences they enjoy cannot compare to the positive consequences generated by thousands upon thousands of people enjoying them when placed in a museum. This explains why Indy was so keen on retrieving the Cross of Coronado. Yes, Panama Hat enjoys it as part of his private collection, but this is not the best option. Consequentialism also offers an explanation for why Indy is more interested in the Ark being placed in Brody's museum than he is any monetary payment from the government for securing it. When the government alters the terms of the deal, but attempts to assure Indy and Marcus that the Ark will be held somewhere very safe, Indy queries from whom it will be safe and complains, "Oh, the money's fine. The situation's totally unacceptable." Marcus adds, "The Ark is a source of unspeakable power, and it has to be researched." The government men do their best to appease them. "And it will be, I assure you, Dr. Brody, Dr. Jones. We have top men working on it right now." Indy is thoroughly disgusted, as he later laments to Marion, "Bureaucratic fools. They don't know what they've got there." Clearly, Indy believes that the government made the wrong choice by not allowing the public, and serious scholars, to have regular access to the Ark. Yet, to be fair, the government is probably following the same logic as Indy and Marcus. They simply disagree with the two scholars about what is best given the situation. A restricted Area 51 warehouse might not be a museum, but isn't the Ark safer from the Nazis, or anyone else, if it's hidden in southern Nevada rather than displayed out in the open in Marcus's Connecticut Museum? Certainly, given how the Ark remains tucked away in its do-not-open dusty crate decades later in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, it seems the government made the right call. One that fits the principle of utility, insofar as it provided the best option for the Ark and for everyone involved, because after what happened to Belloc and Ernst Haut, what top men would really want to risk opening the Ark to study it? Indy, Marcus, and the government men disagree about the facts as they pertain to the happiness and pain or suffering caused by placing the Ark in a public museum as compared to hiding it away in a secret location. Some of these facts pertain to the future, so it's easy to sympathize with the two scholars. Still, it might be that Indy is not thinking clearly about the situation, which gets in the way of his seeing how the greater good is better served if the Ark is not placed in a museum. Perhaps the government is correct in its estimation that consequentialist thinking about the unique case of the Ark leads to overturning Indy's general rule about placing important artifacts in museums. Notably, Indy made a similar decision about the Mayapur Sankara stone. Indy doesn't divulge exactly how he weighs the facts, but his quip that if he took the stone back to Brody's museum, it would just be another rock gathering dust, provides a helpful clue. It seems Indy recognized three options. 1. Keep the stone and sell it to a private collector. 2. Place the stone in a museum. 3. Leave it with the Mayapur villagers. It seems that Indy never really considered 1 as an option. We don't know why, but it might be that by the end of the film he regains his sense of valuing the greater good over his selfish interests. So the fortune and glory he initially sought was not to come from selling the Mayapur stone on the black market to a private collector. Rather, fortune and glory would come to his career as an archaeologist by placing the stone in a museum. Still, it seems that he believes more good will come if he opts for 3 over 2. True, Indy himself would benefit more by opting for 2, but perhaps this is outweighed by a flourishing Mayapur village, where, for generations to come, the stone will protect its villagers and secure them constant happiness. Further, it might be that without the other Sankara stones, the Mayapur stone would not garner that much interest from other scholars or the general public. This further explains his quip about it being just another rock gathering dust. All of this is difficult to know, but at least consequentialism provides a plausible story about why Indy made the choice he did, and why he overturned his general rule about placing important artifacts in a museum. I don't know. I'm making this up as I go. Fans have long noted the apparent inconsistency in Indy's decisions about placing artifacts in a museum. Sometimes he doggedly works to find and place artifacts in a museum, as he does with the Golden Idol, the Ark of the Covenant, and especially the Cross of Coronado. Sometimes he doesn't, for example with the Crystal Skull, the Holy Grail, and especially the Mayapur Sankara Stone. Why? How might we explain this discrepancy? We've considered a plausible answer grounded in consequentialist ethical theory. We should be honest and recognize that perhaps there is no single underlying perspective that neatly explains all of Indy's decisions. He is a fictional character written and filmed by numerous people with diverging artistic goals. Of course, we don't know for sure that consequentialist thinking can explain all of what we see when watching Indy traipse across the globe looking for artifacts. But consequentialism does explain why Indy struggles against the Nazis in Raiders and Crusade and Mola Ram in Temple. If the Nazis or Mola Ram successfully wield occult objects for world domination, that would cause extensive pain and suffering. Almost any other alternative would be better for all those involved. It also helps to explain why Indy believes that important artifacts belong in a museum, and why, when he breaks his own rule, he might not be inconsistent. 3. The virtues that made the man, and the man who became the legend. The Adventures in Philosophy of Young Indiana Jones. Robert M. Mentica. During the 1990s, the Indiana Jones franchise was maintained in the form of the live-action television series The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones. Chronicling Indy's tumultuous past alongside the historical backdrop of the early 20th century, the show was meant to be a semi-educational experience for the entire family, and it won several Emmy Awards during its three-season run. The expanded format of a television series allowed for increased character growth and exploration, while the tighter budget necessitated fewer high-octane stunts in favor of thematic discussions and world-building. Although the franchise was known for its emphasis on history and archaeology, The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones broadened the scope of Indy's interests. The episode Passion for Life, for instance, saw Indiana thrust headfirst into the tumultuous world of art inhabited by figures like Pablo Picasso and Edgar Degas, before shifting gears entirely and introducing Indy to the natural conservation efforts of none other than Theodore Roosevelt. The episode Travels with Father takes a more reflective turn. After trading ideas and baseball cards with Leo Tolstoy in Russia, Indy and his family venture to the inspiring vistas of Greece on their way to a cliffside monastery that houses ancient manuscripts vital to his father's research. As both Henry Jones, Sr. and Jr., get caught up in a series of misadventures while traveling to this monastery, the two strike up a conversation about Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, and the birth of Western philosophy. Using the lessons learned from this discussion, the two are able to successfully arrive at their destination and grow together as father and son. Building on the foundations established in the episode, Travels with Father, this chapter considers Aristotle's approach to ethics, with its emphasis on character development and virtue. Along the way, we'll discover what The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones can teach us about what it means to be good and how human beings can overcome their personal weaknesses. Hollywood Follies on a Television Budget. Although The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones played an important part in keeping the franchise in public awareness prior to the release of Kingdom of the Crystal Skull in 2008, the television series has fallen out of the limelight since then. The entire production was released on DVD in 2007, but shifting rights and licensing agreements have made this collection the only reliable way to watch the series. Little in the way of official merchandise or marketing has been dedicated to the show, making fan websites and internet forums the most reliable source of information about the series. The show began as The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles, a series produced for the ABC television network, first airing in March of 1992. It was pitched as a cost-effective way of continuing the franchise following the original trilogy's success. The shift to television would also allow the production company to take some risks, testing new filming techniques and special effects options in a relatively low-risk environment that wouldn't bankrupt the company if they didn't succeed. In its original run, the series would feature Indy at three different points in his life, as a troublesome youth from Princeton, New Jersey, traveling the world with his parents, as an idealistic young man fighting for his beliefs before settling down for a college education, and as a garrulous retired professor eager to share his stories with anyone who would listen. Each episode was roughly 45 minutes long and would be bookended by the elderly Dr. Jones providing context for the exploits of his younger self. The adventures themselves alternated between the preteen, junior, and adolescent, young Indy, with episodes tending to be more educational while Indy was in grade school before ratcheting up the action during his later teenage years. The production itself was a collaboration of many different writers and directors. Although Indy was accompanied by a small cast of recurring characters, each self-contained episode featured a revolving door of special guest appearances and hundreds of region-specific extras. This constantly evolving cast allowed the show to feature numerous prominent historical figures, staying true to its marketing pitch that audiences would encounter all the action, all the intrigue, all the exciting exploits of the young man who not only witnessed history, he made it. Although the show was a critical success, general audience reaction was lukewarm. Many found the stories too focused on education, and sequences with the elderly Dr. Jones were panned for failing to capture the essence of the hero in his twilight years. The series' numerous writers and directors resulted in a wide variation in episode quality, and the travel costs required to film each episode made the production prohibitively expensive for long-term success. The show's first season was cut short, but it did manage to return for a second season that focused almost entirely on the more action-packed stories of Indy's late teens and early 20s. The Young Indiana Jones Chronicles finished its production run as a series of four television movies created for the Family Channel after having been canceled outright by ABC. This change in format would prompt George Lucas to reevaluate the entire series, heavily re-editing episodes in order to create 23 television movies collectively called The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones. Each of these features would essentially be two episodes tacked together, with varying degrees of success for how seamlessly one episode would transition into another. Segments featuring the elderly Dr. Jones were cut entirely. Subsequently, this version was released to home video.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.